your hands.
Mighty God. This is Ambassador L.F. Craig of the Shelter God Safe House here in Dallas, Texas, the church without walls, because we are the body of Christ, many members, one body, and Christ is the head of the body. Yes, he is. And in the know for new life, get in the know today and you can change your every tomorrow. You have been empowered to change your life. And we have been called to be about the Father's business. We must work the works of him that sent us while it is day, because why? Night is coming and no one will be able to work. And so we're here, and our word for the week, yes, it's a good word. Smart salvation. We talk about smart salvation. If you have not purchased your copy of that book, you can find it at Amazon.com. come under Ambassador L.F. Craig. And is Smart Salvation, what drives your faith? The word for the week that we're pulling out of the book is inheritance. I did not cover the words in detail in the book, but these are the features, some of the features of your smart salvation. You know, when you get that new smartphone, that iPhone, that new laptop computer, your new smart TV, or even some of you may have a smart car. There's a whole lot of things that you have features, and sometimes we don't even use them. They already is embedded in the device that you have. And that's the same way it is with salvation. It's embedded in it. It's already in it. But we have to discover it. It's nothing new to God, but it's new to us. And we have to discover what is in that. And our word for this week is inheritance. What does it really mean to you? Inheritance. You got to put faith in. You got to put faith in. And we're going to do yes, word for the week, inheritance, smart salvation. And I think we are on track. We are thankful to God for this another opportunity. And remember, our key verse for this week is Isaiah 54:13, I believe. No weapon formed against you shall prosper, and every tongue that rise up in against you in judgment you shall condemn. For this is the inheritance of the servants of God, says the Lord. I paraphrase it. Go back and look it up and check that out. Okay. And I think I gave y'all some homework to figure out what verse goes with the verse I gave. I gave a verse and I gave a chapter. I gave the book Deuteronomy and also another. Okay. Let me just start over. Go back and look at the other lessons. Sometimes I forget this is not an actual Bible study where everybody came in and you was present on yesterday and you're present again today. So go back and look at those. It'll help you, give you something to do for yourself. And we're going to move on with today's lesson. Today's lesson, we're looking at, and a lot of the information, like I said, I'm not reinventing the wheel. There are some things that the Spirit is going to give me to add to this, but I looked at the things and some things will give you empowerment and enrich you. It will propel you. Hopefully it would push you and encourage you to want to know what it is that belongs to you. Okay. So you can look at BibleStudyTools.com. There's a lot of resources there. You can Google other sources. You can go to Matthew Henry's commentary. It's a good commentary. You can go to Bible Gateway and pull up other translations and read the verses of scripture where you could better understand how it applies to your life. And then the most important thing that you can do if you want to be empowered and enriched, you have to meditate and pray and learn the voice of the Holy Spirit within you and let the Holy Spirit lead you and guide you and direct you. Yes, God uses people and the Holy Spirit uses people to enrich our lives, but you have to be able to identify the voice when he's using the people to speak into your life. Legal inheritance refers to actual property or goods received after a family member's death. We talked about that, but why in Jewish inheritance customs were linked to family bloodlines, the Greek and the Romans provided if they adopted someone into their family, then their adopted children was also the heir. With Jewish people, only blood. And we talked about adoption. If you go back on go into my YouTube and also post it on Facebook. We done a study, some lessons. We've done 5 lessons on adoption. So if you go back and you look at those lessons we did on adoption, you'll see the difference between the Jews and, we say, Greek and Roman. So Jews and Gentiles, there's 2 groups of people. If you're not a Jew, you're a Gentile. And then that's a different class. Okay. And so we talked about this is inheritance. Okay. In the Old Testament, the term inheritance occurs over 200 times. I told you when I started, there's 214 references that refers, reflected by this word inheritance in the Bible. It talks, if you look up words, heir, inherit, inheritance, heritage. And there's a number of them, and you know, we're not gonna read all of those scriptures, and I'm not gonna give you all of those passages because I'm not enabling you. I'm here to empower you. And so I give you some chunks and some chew. I give you a chunk to chew on so you can chew on it, swallow it, digest it, and build your faith, all right? And so, but almost all references to the inheritance, to the word inheritance in the Old Testament are theological, not legal. It's theological. And also in the New Testament, they're theological. It's not something literally that you can put your hands on per se, because the reason why it says that it's theological is in theory, but it's not tangible, because we are in a kingdom that's not of this world. And that's the problem that they had it in the past. We have it now because we want God to deliver us from all our trouble, from all of our enemies, and, you know, put us in charge. You know, the disciples say, well, so now that you done rose from the dead, will you establish the kingdom? You know, and they wanted to be power. And it's not as the world's, because our kingdom is not a worldly kingdom as physically as we see it, tangible as you may see it. God is the tester. Christ died for a dual purpose, okay? Because we say in a theological sense, to inherit means to receive an irrevocable gift, with an emphasis on the special relationship between the benefactor and the recipients. And usually when we talk about inheritance, someone has to die, okay? God, the creator, never died, okay? So Christ died so that he represented the tester. He represented God, but he also represented us, in that he died for us, and he died for God, okay? In order for God to give us an inheritance, God would have to die, okay? In order for us to be worthy or to be redeemed or to be adopted into the family, we had to die, because the wages of sin is death. But the thing about it, we couldn't come back to life. So Christ died for a dual purpose, okay? And you know, God is just like that, okay? The focus of the inheritance concept in the Old Testament is God's promise to Abraham, because God promised Abraham that the land of Canaan would be given to him and his descendants as an eternal possession, okay? And each family in Israel was appropriated its own inheritance when it was divided up. And this gives you scriptures. If you look at Joshua chapters 13 through chapters 31, okay? It's not Joshua 13 verse 31. It's Joshua chapter 13 through chapter 31, okay? And given the task to occupy the land, okay? And so these just shows how God divided the land, and he gave them land. They actually possessed land, okay? And that's why you still have wars going on, because people are still trying to get back what God promised them, because they believe in God. They believe in God Jehovah. They believe in God Yahweh. And the distinction is that Jesus came to bring freedom and liberation, but it wasn't freedom and liberation from people. It was freedom and liberation to become once again in the family of God. And so sometimes, you know, you say, well, I would take the other, the actual, because we're living in this world and it's a tough thing. From the promise of Canaan as Israel's inheritance came other aspects of the concept. The nation is described as God's inheritance, whom the Lord will never forsake. Okay, because we are God's inheritance and he's our inheritance. It is a dual purpose thing, dual thing that's going on, because God wants to have a relationship with us. And he makes it possible for us to have a relationship with each other. He makes it possible for us to be family. God makes it possible for us to be family. And that's why you have to, it doesn't matter if you someone has an elder brother syndrome, don't want you in the family. God, Jehovah, the creator and sustainer of all life, through Jesus Christ, has made it possible for all of us to be family in the family of God. And we are all King's kids. Okay. What is it really? The focus of the promised inheritance was less on national prominence in the presence and more on a personal participation in the life, in the future life with God. Okay. And so God was talking a lot about when he shall come and be in the midst, and when he shall restore everything to the purpose that he had for it in the beginning, that we would have that fellowship and relationship with God, the creator, that he would be a God in the midst, that he would be walking through, checking on us. We have the Spirit of God that now lives inside of us. The New Testament, as in the Old Testament, as I said, almost all the occurrences of the terms for inheritance in the New Testament are theological, okay? He's not going to give you a piece of, you know, buy you an island and give it to you, okay? Who are the heirs? Three major characters dominate the inheritance usage in the New Testament: Abraham, Christ, and the believers. The New Testament continues to focus on Abraham as the central figure of the inheritance manifold. The initial promise to Abraham of the land of Canaan, you can find it in Hebrews 11 and 8, and it is broadened and includes the world in Romans 4 and 13. Okay, so you go and check out those scriptures, Hebrews 11 and 8, Romans 4 and 13. God's promise and Abraham's faith is not by the works of the law, okay? God's promise and Abraham's faith, not by works of the law, okay? Hebrews 4, 13 through 16. It was not through the law that Abraham and his offspring received the promise that he would be the heir of the world, but through the righteousness that comes by faith. Okay, we have to have faith and believe that what God did through Christ Jesus included us. For if those who depend on the law are heirs, faith means nothing and the promise is worthless. Okay, if the law could have set us free, the Old Testament covenant, if that could have set us free, then there would have been no need for Christ to come. But because we could not fulfill all of those requirements, because they were just stacked on, and you had to be able to chip away what man had added, because there's a lot of things that was imposed in there, because the law brings wrath, and where there is no law, there is no transgression. So the law came to reveal to us that we was out of fellowship with God. The law came to reveal to us that we had trespassed God's law, God's desire, God's purpose in our lives, that we had come short. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So the law come to, as a mirror, to help us to look at ourselves and see, Oh, this is not what God intended for me. This is not what God intended. And then he comes and he gives us the law of grace and faith so that we can become what he has declared us to be from the foundation of the world. Therefore, the promise comes by faith so that it may be by grace and may be guaranteed to all Abraham's offspring, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who have the faith of Abraham, not faith in Abraham, but the faith of Abraham. Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. He is the father of all of us. Okay. Galatians 3 and 18 say, for if the inheritance depends on the law, then it no longer depends on the promise. Okay, so our inheritance is not dependent on the law. And I know they sing this song, if I live right, heaven belongs to me. If I live right, heaven belongs to me. No, heaven belongs to me because God promised it. Heaven belongs to me because I have a right to it. Yes, I'm supposed to do good works. Yes, I'm supposed to walk in love. I'm supposed to love God with all of my heart, my soul, my strength, my being. I'm supposed to love my neighbor as myself, and everyone is my neighbor, and everyone is my brother and sister in Christ Jesus, because every person has been created after the image and the likeness of God. Every person that comes into this earth comes in this earth in the similitude of God the Creator. Okay. But it's not because of what I do that gets me the inheritance. It's what God has done for me and promised to give me at the end of life. But God, in his grace, gave it to Abraham through a promise, okay? So it was given as a promise, okay? The second major character is Jesus Christ. His preeminent position as the Son of God uniquely qualifies him as God's heir, naturally, because he's the firstborn of many brethren, many children of God. He is the beloved Son of God. He's the only begotten Son of God. So yes, everything that belongs to God belongs to Jesus Christ. Okay. He is presented as the heir of all things. If you read Hebrews 1st chapter 1 and 2, verses 2 and 4, if you go and read Hebrews, Hebrews is actually the covenant. If you take the cross and you lay it down in Hebrews, you'll find so many similitudes. This is our new covenant. It's the better covenant. Okay. For those of us that is under grace, you need to read the book of Hebrews. And I don't care. I'm not fighting on who wrote it, who's the author and all of that stuff. That's not so, because sometimes we argue over points that's not important. What does it tell me that I have? I don't care who wrote it. What does it tell me that I have? And did God say it? Did God declare it? Did God give the author of it to write it? And does it apply to my life? Okay. Christ is our high priest, and he can be touched by the feelings of our infirmities, and the promise of God's kingdom are focused in him. Okay. And we told you that, you know, and some want to kill him, because they think that if they kill Jesus, then they could take the leadership role and they could keep and own what that belongs to God. But what they didn't understand is, even though he laid down his life, he had the power and the authority to pick it up again. And that's why we are now joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Had he had just died and never rose, we would have nothing to inherit from God, because we would still owe the penalty of our own sins, because he didn't have the ability to come and give us life. But praise God for the gift of grace. The third major character is the believer. Okay. Believer, all of the believers. If you're a believer, I'm a believer. I'm a believer. Are you a believer? I believe in Jesus Christ. I believe that he's the Son of God. I believe that God sent him into this world. I believe that he died for my sins, but he also rose for my justification, that he not only saved me from hell, but he gave me new life. Okay. And this is the stuff that you have to know, that now you have new life. Birth is instant, but life is a process, and you got to walk out what's been birthed in. Okay. Finally, for the believers in Christ, her heirship is a natural result of justification. He saved us so that, having been justified by grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. Since all believers are children of God, they are necessarily heirs of God. It follows naturally that Christians also are heirs along with Abraham and Christ, okay? And so you have to understand that Abraham's seed is the seed that God gave him, and it told him that he would be the father of many nations, and it was by the promise that he gave, not by the works. The law comes that we may know how far away from God we've gotten. Jesus came to bring us back into fellowship and relationship. What is the inheritance? Generally, the promise refers to the possession of salvation. The believer's inheritance is described more specifically as eternal and joyful existence with God, to be with him. Believers are promised an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven, reserved for us. Inheriting the world to come is a guarantee for all of us that belongs to God's family. All of us that belongs to God's family. And there's nothing higher, there's nothing greater than being a part of the family of God. I don't care how many millions of dollars you may have, or you may get, or whatever. Money answers all things, but it doesn't give you relationship and adopt you into the family of God. It takes care of the things that you need in this earth, okay? And so you can't love it, okay? It is a resource. Is used to exchange, is an exchange for goods and services, okay? But God, the inheritance that he has for us is that we are guaranteed to live with him forever and to be king's kids and given a kingdom and given a position of authority. Now, he's just checking out, how do we handle that right now? Okay, how do we treat other people right now? Because God operates on the law of love. All right, so that's my chunk, my nuggets that I have for you today. And so I pray that you would take them, look over them, examine them, keep what you need, the part you don't think is for you. It's like sifting flour, okay? I am Ambassador L.F. Craig of the Shelter God Safe House here in Dallas, Texas, a church without walls, because we are the body of Christ. We are a walking, talking, moving organism that's organized, fitly joined together. Many members, one body. We all got a gift. We all got fruit. And let you know that you have value. Pull your gift out. Share it with the world. You can make a difference because God sent you to make a difference in the life of somebody. Yes, our inheritance, it belongs to you.
Here we go, y'all. It belongs to me. Salvation belongs to me. And I have everything to make salvation complete. I know the work is already done by the power of his blood. I know it's mine. It belongs to me. It belongs to me. Healing belongs to me. And I have everything that makes my healing complete. It doesn't matter. When his stripes say I am healed.